Yeah, thank you, Taro, for that time. I really appreciate that. I know you're very busy, so I'm going to keep it short. And the basics of it would be how viewers can learn from your amazing journey. So, how about we start from you? Who is Tarun before we start about Green Gems?
Who is Tarun? So Tarun is a very curious engineer turned material scientist. Basically, I was an engineer first, and I went into environmental science, and then came back into engineering, civil engineering specifically, and then started working with building materials. So I essentially, the one, if there was just one trait that would define me, it is basically curiosity. I'm very inquisitive. I always try to learn new stuff. So that includes anything and everything. I'm a very avid reader. I love to read anything under the sun. Maybe not teenage fan fiction or web books. Even though I did actually at some point when I was a teenager, but I quickly outgrew them. So that's basically me. I mean, that's essentially me in a few words.
Okay, so why civil engineering? Out of pressure of the family to become an engineer, or you were curious about actually curious about the infrastructure?
Oh no, I was a completely lost child. I had no idea what I wanted to do after my 10th. I mean, I think after 10th, I essentially wanted to become a doctor. Because as a kid, I used to love writing prescriptions. And my mom thought it's only when you become a doctor you can write prescriptions. Turns out a few decades later, right now, I mean, I still scribble stuff in my notebook and still look like prescriptions, except that the formulae and equations and the designs and stuff like that, so they still look pretty illegible. But then, yeah, like after 10, I was actually a pretty lost child. I did not really understand what I had to do with life. But fortunately, my dad is an engineer, a pretty accomplished one, actually, a civil engineer, actually. So I did a small stint in the US. I got into the New York University for electrical engineering, even though I had no idea what electrical engineers do. I thought, you basically put electrical lines instead of building. That was my understanding of an electrical engineer. Unfortunately, it came as a rude shock, but that's not what we did, and I performed really poorly. So I dropped out, I came back, and then again I was in this sort of a dilemma. My dad was like, "See, I'm a civil engineer, I know this shit. I know you can do it, so become a civil engineer." And I was like, "Okay, let's do it." And then I started, and then along the way, I started liking the subject. Not all of it, of course. But there were a few bits about civil engineering that is still open, undiscovered, and had a few aspects that could be worked upon. In fact, I was one of the toppers in my college when it came to concrete technology and the specific broad subject on building materials. I mean, these sort of things essentially got me very interested and curious. And thereon, I sort of started developing a conscience, I guess, and a little bit of consciousness. So towards the end of my engineering was when I became aware of climate change and the contribution of buildings to climate change. And I was like, man, we need to change the way that we build. And once I joined the workforce, I did not want to propagate, which had already been happening in basically steel and concrete and very energy inefficient buildings. So which again, I mean, all of these things contributed. I was like, we need a material, we need to find an alternative that could potentially make this planet a better place to live in. And that was when I happened upon hempcrete, and then finished my engineering, and then I still have no direction. So, as any engineer would do with no direction in life, I've decided to do a master's. So that's basically it. That's my background. I did a master's, and then during my master's, I was one of those very few kids who essentially actually had a thesis in hand, like a topic in hand for my master's thesis. So it was hempcrete. And I studied hempcrete for 2 years straight up, all during my college days, just trying to figure out, you know, what this material is, how it could be done, I mean, what needs to be done to bring it to the market and stuff like that. And by the time I finished my master's, I developed a pretty good network of professionals, of entrepreneurs, of people in the hemp industry, passionate about hemp and cannabis. And it was then that I saw all of these people and I was like, man, I mean, we're definitely going to have a hemp industry and it would be amazing to essentially develop a technology for hempcrete, which is suitable for India. And that's when I decided that we need to start a company and develop hempcrete for the Indian construction industry and then take it forward. No background in business. I mean, my family is actually not into business. Most of them are self-employed or employed or and essentially second gen, third gen traders, not even business folks. So basically had no foundation like that, knew nothing about business, and I still started this thanks to my dad. He was able to support me this entire time that I was on this journey of self-discovery. See, I mean, around the same time in 2017, I started Green Gems, and then there was a singular goal of developing hempcrete for the Indian construction industry, and I also enrolled for a PhD. Two reasons. I mean, one, I needed the technical skills required to develop a product such as this, because there was no one in India who knew this product or even understood it or had done any prior work on this. I was pretty much the only guy. So I needed a certain amount of skills. So decided to do a PhD, and then along the way also figure out how business works and you know, essentially bring this to the market. So I gave myself about 2 years to develop the product and then also learn the foundations of the basics of business. So along the way we did, I was actually fortunate enough to be supported by my brother. He was still studying law, but also with on just on the basis of the merit of the product, right? With won a few grants and an accelerator program by What Design Can Do. This was a Netherlands-based company that gave us $10,000 euros, which was again supported by IKEA Foundation and UNFCCC. And then they also ran this accelerator program where they taught us everything that is about running a social enterprise, not just any startup, but something with a social angle. So things get a lot more complicated when you bring in the social angle, the impact angle as well.
Right. It goes so much in line with what Nitin Gadkari have been mentioning lately about there is so much of a need to develop products which are carbon negative and actually help to, you know, not to contribute to global warming anymore, especially that comes from cement and steel industry, which is like the second largest one. So yeah. So you were already like on it before he even mentioning about it. So that was nice. And I'm pretty sure you would have benefited by that. You being the first one, as you said, in a family to start all these things, do you start it alone or you have a co-founder or anyone, or you take care of everything?
So I started alone in 2017. In 2019, my brother finished his law, and then he decided to reject the offers that he had in hand, and he joined Green Gems simply because of the mission that I was on. And I mean, I'm actually pretty fortunate that everyone believed in the mission, my family, my brother, my friends, and I have the support of all of those guys. That's basically how it started. When 2019 was when I actually hit another wall. We basically had this amazing technology in terms of hempcrete, well suited to India, but unfortunately, world's strongest hempcrete actually. But unfortunately, we don't yet have a hemp industry, right?
Right.
There's not enough hemp growing in the country. There are multiple challenges when it comes to working with hemp, simply because we don't have a policy. Mm-hmm. And we also don't have, because we don't have a policy, we don't have enough people cultivating it. And therefore, even though there's no dearth of the raw material in India, like you have like hemp growing almost everywhere in the wild. And I mean, if I decide to do it, I could simply pick it up from the vial and then start making bricks out of it. But a lot of these other linkages, right, that did not work out. Like, for example, supply chain. Like, I would end up spending a lot of money sending people to all of these far-flung areas to harvest the wild hemp, bring it to me, process it. It was becoming a long-drawn process. And there were no others. So essentially, you need the coexistence. Right? So for example, so when you talk about agrocrete, anyway, so I'll come to the agrocrete story in a little bit. And all of this happened. And then in 2019 was when I figured out that this wasn't working out and I needed to somehow do something. So I was thinking maybe I could license the technology to an international entity, to an international market. You know, there was a lot of acceptance for hemp, and hemp also had a policy, and you know, there was enough cultivation happening as well. It was during this phase when I was considering this was when I happened upon the extremely poor air quality in Delhi, and this was October 2019, and I was like, man, this is messed up. And why is everyone in Delhi, you know, spending a quarter of a year, their entire lives, in this kind of an air quality?
Right.
And I have no prior experience of this. I mean, so I'd been to Delhi a few times before. I never really liked the air. I always thought this was how things are. But then, you know, after you get on this journey, right? I mean, you know, you only become more curious.
Right.
And then I started trying to understand why this even happens. That was when I figured out that about 44% of Delhi's air quality, poor air quality. Yeah. So I was trying to understand what the reason was, and I figured out that almost 44% of Delhi's poor air quality is because of paddy straw burning.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, there's so much paddy straw being burned that essentially means there's an abundance, which is why, you know, people are discarding it. And I wanted to figure out how we could use this straw. And I already had this technology in terms of hemp. And I was like, let's see if we can replace hemp with paddy and, you know, come up with another building material. A few tens of trials later, almost 100 trials later, was when I essentially was successful at, you know, incorporating paddy straw into this technology that I had. And I was like, hey, amazing. Let's call it agrocrete and then figure out how we could bring this to the market, if it has to be a blog, if it has to be a panel, if it has to be something else.
Okay, so residual was not the first choice. It's just you stumped into somehow while you were in Delhi, when the first choice was ham. So right now you're more of into like using residuals, right? To create your bricks.
Crop residuals, like stuff like paddy straw, bagasse, wheat straw, cotton straw, corn straw. There are a huge amount of residuals.
Availability also, right? Yeah, and there is a lot of availability. So you don't have to struggle like you have to struggle for the ham. So that's really nice one. And this just look like, it sounds like any other like movie story where you are in a problem instead of you are at a place where, you know, you have been in a direction, sent to a direction that somehow you stump on something and you're like, okay, I figured it out. How to make it work, right?
Yeah, it was like it. It was exactly like it. Yeah. It was like a godsend.
But does it make a difference in the cost or the quality of the product if you switch from ham to any other residual?
Yes, the difference is we've been able to create a much better product. So it still is lightweight, it still is carbon negative, it still does not involve a lot of emissions during the manufacturing, it still is pretty thermally insulating as well.
That's nice. And since you're getting it from I guess most of it is coming from Punjab in that case, or Haryana in that region?
No, so it's what's interesting is this is a more spread out problem. It's there across the country.
Okay.
So in India, we burn approximately 100 million tons of crop residues, right? And in Punjab and Haryana, so basically in the Delhi NCR region, that's only about 40 million tons. So the remaining 60% of you know, crop residues being burnt is actually across the country.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that a lot of it goes unaccounted for. And because Delhi is so landlocked and so congested and, you know, has so many vehicles, the problem amplifies, and that's essentially why, you know, there's that hue and cry.
Right, and there has been so many like things going on in media about the politics going around and how like Delhi is paying for what has been burned on the fields. So I'm pretty sure this is gonna solve a lot of the your problem, and I can see that maybe in coming future the government is gonna give you subsidies and help you out with the supply chain as well, maybe since this is a problem that's also like helping the solution to this problem also helping them somehow, right?
It is. So while that is the case, we do not expect the government to be, doing any
Right.
help. They figured out our own ways. We figured out our own methods. As long as, we don't have any unnecessary interferences from, fringe groups, which we seem to have many in India. We're more than happy. I mean, we figured out the whole logistics, we figured out the whole supply chain. We don't really need to be need any subsidies or support. I mean, they're always welcome, of course. But I guess a company is only is worth its salt only if it can operate independently. And I
Right.
don't think any organization should depend on a government to carry out business.
Right. And so your direct competitors are these people who are not all these companies who are actually using cement, right? And making the actual bricks from limestone and stuff. So how much of their market you're trying to tap on, and how is your business model looks like? Although you have a really nice rice product, but not necessarily usually a nice product is going to succeed, right? It needs a really good business model behind it. So what's your business model to compete with all these big people?
So there are a few things about the bricks and blocks industry, right? About the building materials industry specifically. Everything is decentralized. Like even when you look at cement, you don't expect cement to travel long distances. They travel at max for 300, 400 kilometers, not more than that. And that's essentially why we have so many cement companies all across the country.
Right.
And that's basically because, they have to be close to the market that particular factory is looking to serve. So similarly with bricks and blocks also, they always come from the local markets. They don't travel long distance. And that's basically where we came up with this very innovative business model. We call it franchise manufacturing.
Okay.
So what we're actually helping, what we're actually doing is we're helping individual entrepreneurs set up their own manufacturing units of aggregate. What we give them is a license to the brand. We give them technical support, QA support, and most importantly, we give them the key component, which is the binder, without which aggregates cannot be manufactured. So that is essentially how we're looking to grow. And for happy to report that we've received a huge amount of interest. A lot of people are looking to set up these aggregate manufacturing units across the country. So we're right now having a boatload of conversations trying to figure out who would be the best partner in that particular location.
That's really amazing. That's a really nice idea because it's actually going to solve the biggest problem that, as I can understand, is the logistics and the supply chain. So that's very innovative. So as you were saying that you're going to have provide them technical support and stuff. So is their product like the binder, is all these things are patented or is free licensed?
So aggregate itself as a whole product is patented. Anyone who wants to use straw and the other components in making aggregate would be in breach of the patent. So we have essentially the patent in both the process and the composition.
Amazing.
And we've gone for this very, very wide, all-encompassing patent. So it would be really difficult for anyone to squeeze or find loopholes and try to come up with a viable product.
Nice. So you have been in this business for 4 years, right? So how big is the team now?
So in fact, I've only been in this business in so to 2017 to 2019, I was purely in product development, essentially
Okay.
trying to understand the market, basically learning the basics of business. It was in 2019 that we actually actively started you know, promoting AgroFeed and, you know, basically trying to make it work. So October 2019, late 2019 was when we incorporated a different entity and, you know,
and COVID
started doing serious business. And then, yeah, March 2020, COVID hit. It was the worst. Yeah.
So in this span of yours, like, there will be so many like yours, you know, who want to, would be the first generation in the family who want to start a business and might have problems like COVID and have innovative product. What are the, I would say, I'm going to break it down into three questions. What is the biggest challenge you faced in this like 4 years and which actually helped you to in fact grow when you actually try to solve it?
No, I think I already covered a few challenges.
Yes.
One, the hemp industry. And it was essentially, I think the one thing that helped me overcome the problem with hempcrete and, you know, come up with a completely new product called AgroCrete and help solve a much larger problem was simply awareness.
Right.
So just being self-aware. You know, just being aware to the surroundings, to problems that you encounter and, you know, having a mindset where you start asking questions, right? Being actually inquisitive in a time when things aren't looking good for you.
Right.
Right. So I think that was essentially the one quality, I think, the one trait that helped me get out of this. And there are always multiple challenges, right? In terms of, so for example, after we created AgroFeed, we didn't really figure out what form it had to be in.
Mm-hmm.
So all of these people, all of the experts that we spoke to, were like, you know, you have to make panels, you have to make panels. Panels are the future. I mean, you can't be making bricks and blocks. What is interesting in bricks and blocks? Panel or something that is exciting. And I'm like, cool. I'm not going to take your word at face value. But I will essentially try and validate it. So then I started like studying other panel technologies and, you know, where they were in the current industry. I mean, what position they were in, what the acceptability is, are they being adopted well? And I soon realized that that's not the case. I mean, panels have seen a very, very high ratio of failure. A lot of the people who invested in panel technology were shutting shop. A lot of builders who worked with panels were, you know, kind of turning out to be unhappy. Literally 15 years is what the life of a panel-based building is. And I was like, that's not a good sign. I don't want to be a part of that crowd. And further, making panels is also more expensive, right? I mean, the capital investment required to set up the manufacturing equipment to make panels is also more expensive. So I was like, bricks and blocks are not sexy. They're not all that exciting, but they are necessary. So that's something which the market wants or the market needs. So it's always about reading between the lines. And a lot of people discouraged us from doing this because they were like, you will face a huge amount of competition from red bricks and various other blocks that there are. The cement industry is going to become your enemy number one. And I'm like, this is literally a 1,05,000 crore rupees market. It is huge.
Right.
And largely unorganized.
Right.
There is space for literally everyone.
Right.
Anyone can come in and, you know, take a small share. And, you know, and you also have certain policies that are in your favor. I mean, the government does not want people to use red bricks.
Right.
The government does not want people to set up newer burnt clay brick kilns. I mean, there's definitely going to be a void. Someone has to come in and fill that void. And fly ash bricks are not all that exciting. They're not essentially, you know, making a good case, a solid case. So I was like, I sort of went against a lot of the advice that we got.
Mm-hmm.
Basically trusted intuition. And also, I mean, there was good logic, I think, in what I was thinking. And I think we're at a stage where, you know, we're with a product which has much better acceptability. We have a product where the learning curve is extremely small. We have a product where the nations are easy, are very familiar with. There are no challenges in terms of deploying it. Pretty much everyone is happy with what we've done. I mean, obviously the ones who set panels and competition and all of those do not say the same things anymore. But yet again, I mean, there's still a long way to go, a lot more to do before we can actually say that, hey, what we did was right.
Who doesn't know, understand what panel is, can you like explain what's a panel instead of like the kind of design you have?
So when you make a wall, you join two bricks together, right?
Right.
But instead of that, these days you get these sheets which are made of cement and some fiber, or gypsum and some fiber. Okay. And what you do is you essentially construct a metal frame.
Okay.
And then you put this sheet and then you screw it to the metal frame. It's very, very fast. It's an extremely fast way of building walls.
Understood.
But then again, panels are expensive. The frame is expensive. And right. One screw done wrong and your panel cracks in half.
Right. That's in fact, as a layman, I can tell this, not idle, but also the frame would be made of steel, right? So
yeah, the frame would be made of steel.
Yeah. So again, your product is basically avoiding steel or anything like that. And it's more carbon negative. In fact, I already studied about carbon negative when I was studying about you, but just for anybody watching this, how would you explain like what is carbon negative and you mean how your product is carbon negative helping actually the climate?
So in simple terms, a carbon negative product is not adding carbon dioxide emissions to the planet, but in fact is removing it from the atmosphere. That's basically what a carbon negative product does.
Okay.
And the mechanism through which we're doing this is slightly complex and simple, actually. It's not something that we do. It's what the farmers do by growing crops through the photosynthesis process. These plants are sucking CO2 from the air, basically turning into the organism of the plant. And that plant is made completely out of CO2 from the atmosphere. So we take that and then we put it inside the block and we're locking it up. That's essentially how we're able to retain the carbon negative nature of the material.
Okay.
So obviously when we do the whole life cycle analysis of the product, right from the extraction of raw materials to the processing and everything, there are stages in which we're definitely adding a small amount of carbon dioxide emissions to the planet. But it is way, way, way smaller than what the crop residues have already captured from the air. So when you do like a whole summation, like the whole equation, like when you do an accounting of all of this, the net result will be in the negative values.
Yeah, I was also watching one of your videos where you're explaining this, that in your latest one of your project, you actually saved 3.1 tons of carbon dioxide, like you, carbon negative, right?
Yeah.
That was pretty amazing. And on the same video, I was actually amazed to see that. And it's interesting that you actually save money by using this product. Instead, usually when you see all these climate friendly products, like a simple example would be like going from a polythene plastic bags to actual cotton bags is expensive. Whereas your product instead is cheaper, I would say more affordable compared to the bricks. So that's really interesting.
That because of the lighter weight of the material and the higher strength, we're essentially able to make larger block sizes. So because of which the number of mortar joints reduced, the pace at which the mason is able to work increases. By 60% actually, because of which we're able to reduce the cost of construction by almost 50%.
Right.
Up to 50%. In most cases, the minimum that we save is 35-40%.
Right. So it also may be not only good for you, but anybody, as you said, as for a business model, you have franchises. If anybody has a franchise, it's also very good for them because they have a lot of buffer to take their margin in. Right, because they're already spending less on the construction of it or actually the cost of the product, so that's very nice for them as well. So as like as if you can see the industry, this particular segment is growing by like 16% per year by year. So with this business model that you have, what are the growth plans for Green Gems? Like how fast you will be growing and what are the next steps? And you know, a typical employee question is, where do you see in 5 years?
I mean, we're a startup, right? So when you're a startup, everything is much faster. Because of two reasons. One, you have the factor of innovation. If you do not have innovation in your business, then you're hardly a startup. I mean, anyone calls them as a startup these days. and the second aspect is that, you know, when you're a funded startup, it's not just you who is pushing you to perform, but also the investors, the other stakeholders, everyone behind you, you know, putting their contributions, you know, putting in their mind, effort, and everything. And therefore, you grow at a much faster clip. So 15% annualized growth rate is actually very small. The rate at which we're growing in terms of the baseline is 300% a year. At least this year, this financial year, we grew at 300%. The next financial year, we're looking at maintaining the sort of a trajectory. We have a hockey stick in the making.
Yeah, that's huge. And with the kind of product you said and the business model, I'm positive that it's going to be happening until unless like there are any hiccups maybe happening for any weird reasons that keeps on happening in the, you know, kind of a startup. And you so rightly said, and it's a message that we should pass on the viewers, that there needs to be part of innovation in a startup. Like you can't, if you're doing anything which anybody else is doing, you're just doing another business, but it's not like a startup. And the other thing that you mentioned is like definitely the curiosity and you're learning and doing so many things. And it's also, I think the blood is so hot that you want to, you know, make this happen, as this is like your first child kind of a thing. So definitely that all boils up and helps you to have a startup, like, you know, to reach to the levels that you want to. So that's really nice. Before we wrap, what are the like three things that you want to share that actually help you grow a lot, and you can, you know, you would advise to all the young entrepreneurs or any wannabe entrepreneur who have an innovative idea and want to start a startup?
So always build for the market. Do not make the same mistake as what I did by, you know, trying to develop hempcrete for the Indian construction industry. I did not validate the market enough. Mm-hmm. And I mean, again, like I basically knew nothing about starting a business. So I had to grow up in the dark for a bit. But then, yeah, I mean, my advice would be to build for the market. Do not build a product and try to force fit it according to the market, or you know, force fit the market according to the solution that you have built. So it's very important to have the right kind of a problem market fit and then the product market fit. The second thing is be self-aware and trust your intuition. Because a lot of times you might get some amazing advice from amazing people, but then again, I mean, everyone's human, so everyone is making mistakes, and they're not following your journey, so they don't really know what you know. You're the one who's making the product, so at times you have to trust your intuition. And the third thing is build. This is specific to product people, you know, basically building physical product or basically any kind of product, and not in the service space. Build intelligently. You know, you have to account for the whole, you'll have to account for the outcomes of each stage of the system. You essentially have to create a system where the primary purpose is not only to make money, but that essentially becomes a secondary or the tertiary, the outcome of the work that you're doing. But the primary goal is essentially to create a better world and, you know, choose a mission accordingly so that, you know, you are able to drive a massive change. And automatically, I mean, money is only going to be a byproduct.
So we
thank
really
you so much, Karan.
Wish you all
very
the
kind.
Best. And
thank you.
Hope we're gonna... I'm actually looking forward to like living a house which is built by using your bricks for sure.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you for your time. We'll talk soon.
For sure. Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.